The Selfish Gene, Chapter 3, by Richard Dawkins. Immortal Coils. In this chapter, Dawkins elaborates more on the definition of genes and why it is a practical unit for studying natural selection. Through his explanation, he makes clear why the title of the book is called The Selfish Gene. Different survival machines appear very different inside and outside. For example, an octopus is nothing like a mouse and an oak tree. However, the fundamental chemistry of their genes are the same. We are all survival machines for the same kind of replicators, molecules called DNA. Monkey is a machine that preserves genes up trees, and fish is a machine that preserves genes in the water. In his discussion of DNAs, Dawkins assumes that DNAs are much the same as the first replicators in the primeval soup. Of course, they may be related or totally different, or their survival machines were taken at a later stage by DNA. Alexander Graham Cann Smith has also hypothesized that the first replicators may have been inorganic crystals. So what is a DNA? Deoxyribonucleic acid, or DNA, consists of a long chain of building blocks called nucleotides, and pair nucleotide chains twist together in a double helix, or what Dawkins calls the immortal coil. There are only four different kinds of building blocks within all animals and plants, and the difference is in the sequence of the building blocks. The amazing thing is that your DNA is distributed across all cells in the body, and almost every cell contains a complete copy of the body's DNA. They are housed in the nucleus of the cell. DNA molecules perform two important functions. Firstly, they replicate and make copies of themselves, and have become extremely adept at this function. The most obvious example is how all human beings can start off as just a single cell and are faithfully replicated until each human becomes billions of cells. Secondly, DNA indirectly supervises the manufacture of different kinds of molecules known as proteins. DNA, through RNA, gives instructions to produce amino acids which make proteins. At the most basic level, the DNA sequence contains start and stop signals that provide instructions for proteins. Proteins make up the body and regulate its chemical processes. This means that genes that excel in the control of embryonic development and pass its genes on would be naturally selected and favored. Dawkins once again reminds us that replicators operate blindly and have no conscious foresight or purpose. Modern replicators are highly gregarious and work together with other genes to create its machine. This interdependence is further promoted in sexual reproduction, where genes are mixed and shuffled. An individual body is just a temporary vehicle for a short-lived combination of genes. The combination is short-lived, but the genes are potentially very long-lived and immortal. Genes can cross and recross and meet with each other down the generations. For humans, we house 46 volumes of DNA, called chromosomes, or 23 pairs of chromosomes. For each pair, we inherit half of the chromosomes from the father through the sperm, and half of the chromosomes from the mother through the egg. If there's a contradiction in the instructions, one reading of the genes will prevail over another. For example, in the instance of eye color, where two instructions are available, blue eyes will be ignored and the body would manufacture brown eyes. Genes that are ignored are called recessive. The genes for brown eyes are dominant genes. Therefore, blue eyes will only exist if both copies are passed on. Genes that compete for the same slot on a chromosome are called alleles of each other. For genes, Dawkins argues that alleles are synonymous with rival. Our genes are given during conception, and when we refer to the gene pool, we're referring to the genes of the population. When cells divide, normal cell division is called mitosis. Another kind of cell division called meiosis occurs in the production of sex cells, the sperm or egg, which are unique because they only contain 23 sets of chromosomes, not 46 like in other somatic or non-sex cells. This is because they fuse in sexual fertilization to make a new cell that has 46 sets of chromosomes. In meiosis, bits of chromosomes usually swap and reshuffle in a process called crossing over. This creates patchwork arrangements of maternal and paternal genes of chromosomes. We come back to the question of how to define a gene. If we like, we can define genes as a sequence of nucleotides lying between the start and end signals that code for proteins, which are called cistrons, a term that is sometimes used interchangeably with the term genes. Dawkins uses George C. Williams' definition of a gene as any portion of the chromosomal material that potentially lasts long enough generations to serve as a unit of natural selection. We can imagine a sequence of code letters, a length of chromosome called genetic unit. The shorter the genetic unit, the longer in generations this genetic unit is likely to live because there is a smaller probability it will be split up during crossing over. For a very large genetic unit, there is a 50% chance the unit will be split up at each meiosis. If a genetic unit is 1% of the length of the chromosome, it makes sense to assume it only has 1% chance of being split during meiotic division. By tracing the ancestry of a small genetic unit back enough, we can also work out its original creator and common ancestor. Other than crossing over, a new genetic unit can also be formed through mutations. Point mutations are errors changing one code of the sequence. Mutations can also be inversions where pieces of the chromosomes detach and reattaches itself in the inverted position. Although usually devastating, sometimes inversions can be beneficial by bringing a closer linkage of genetic materials that complement and reinforce each other. Natural selection would then favor new genetic units that create beneficial effects through considerable rearrangement and editing. Dawkins explains the phenomenon of mimicry and gives an example of how disgusting tasting butterflies are brightly and distinctively colored as warning marks for birds. Other butterflies may try to mimic them by displaying the same colored markings and fool birds into not eating them. In this way, natural selection favors genes for mimicry, and this is how it evolves. Mimics, however, cannot try to mimic all species. It must commit to one species. Any intermediates or those that try to mimic both would be eaten and therefore negatively selected out. If, say, one butterfly mimics species A and another mimics species B, Dawkins argues that one gene probably cannot control all aspects of mimicry, for example, color, shape, spot patterns, flight rhythms. However, through the editing by inversions and other rearrangements, a large complex of formerly separate genes come together in a tight linkage and behaves like a single gene. The clusters are rarely split up by crossing over, so an intermediate butterfly is never seen in nature but can turn up if large numbers are bred in laboratories. Dawkins clarifies his use of the term gene and says that length of chromosome likely to be split up by crossing over or mutations makes it less qualified to be called a gene. A cistron may qualify as a gene, but so may a dozen cistrons closely linked together that they constitute a single long-lived genetic unit and travel together during meiosis on their journey down to the next generation. Gregory Mendel stated that hereditary units can be treated in practice as indivisible and independent. Although cistrons are sometimes divisible and two genes on the same chromosome are not wholly independent, Dawkins' definition of a gene as a unit that is seldom divided, present or absent in an individual, and passes from grandparent to grandchild is close to the ideals of Mendelian inheritance. This means that genes do not continuously blend with each other, otherwise natural selection would be impossible. In this sense, genes are potentially mortal and do not grow senile as they can live in forms of copies of itself, leaping from survival machine to survival machine down the generations, potentially for hundreds of millions of years. Dawkins argues that individuals, groups, or species are too large and temporary to qualify as a significant unit of natural selection. A practical unit of natural selection should be the largest entity which possesses the properties of longevity, fecundity, and copying fidelity, which will be a gene. As genes compete directly for their alleles for survival, any gene that behaves to increase their chances of survival by acting selfishly instead of altruistically tend to survive. Hence, the gene is the basic unit of selfishness. It is useful to remember that genes are not free and independent agents in controlling embryonic development, as they interact in complex ways with other genes and the external environment, such as temperature, food, predators, companions. Like, there is no single factor that makes a plant grow. There are infinite numbers of antecedent causes that makes a baby. Nonetheless, differences between babies, for example, the difference in the length of the legs, may be traced to one or a few differences in environment or genes. Differences matter in the competitive struggle to survive. Furthermore, if a herbivore acquires genes that confer sharp meat-eating teeth, but without the right sort of intestine for eating meat, they would be bad genes for a herbivore gene pool. Another quality of successful genes is the tendency to postpone the death of their survival machines until after reproduction. Genes that make its possessors die are called lethal genes, and those that have debilitating effects are called semi-lethal genes. Based on Peter Medawar's theory of aging, lethal genes will tend to be removed from the gene pool, but some late-acting lethal genes may be more stable and successful in the gene pool than early-acting ones, provided the lethal effects show after the body has at least reproduced. This may explain genes that cause cancer in old age that may be passed to numerous offsprings, whereas genes that give young adults cancer would not be passed to many offsprings. According to this theory, senile decay is the accumulation in the gene pool of late-acting lethal and semi-lethal genes, as there is less selection pressure against these genes. Dawkins also addresses the question of what sexual reproduction and crossing over is good for. Crossing over does not happen in all species. Male fruit flies do not do it, and female fruit flies have genes that can suppress it. Also, there are alternatives to sex. Female green flies can bear fatherless female offsprings containing all the genes of its mother. Plants can propagate by sending out suckers and become detached from the parent. Sex appears paradoxical because it is an inefficient way for individuals to propagate their genes. But if we consider individuals as short-lived survival machines, efficiency is irrelevant. Genes for sexuality, crossing over, or those that induce mutations manipulate other genes for its own selfish ends, and this is sufficient explanation for its own existence, which Dawkins concedes is dangerously close to being a circular argument. Dawkins states that the immediate manifestation of natural selection is almost always at the individual level, but changes in gene frequencies in the gene pool are the long-term consequences of non-random individual death and reproductive success, the process of evolution. Sex and crossing over keeps the gene pool well stirred and partially shuffles the genes. When considering the evolution of a certain characteristic, Dawkins reminds us to get into the habit of thinking about the effects on the frequencies of the genes in the gene pool.